and welcome to Witness, where we bring you the best of independent filmmaking from around the world, stories with a particularly personal focus. I'm Rida Fakhri.
The desire for self-determination drives people even in the furthest corners of the world, places like West Papua. In the 1960s, the Dutch ceded control of Indonesia with an agreement that Papuans would get a chance to vote on independence or integration with Indonesia. In 1969, West Papua formally voted to accept Indonesian rule. But many Papuans believed that the vote was rigged, and ever since, separatists have been fighting for independence, a fight that's gone largely unnoticed because the Indonesian government tightly controls the foreign media's access to the area. Australian director Jono van Hest arranged for 6 video cameras to be smuggled into different parts of the territory and for local people to be trained how to use them. 1 year later, he returned undercover to bring their stories back out to the world, the stories of the Pride of Warriors.
West Papua might look like a tropical paradise, but what you are about to see are 4 extraordinary stories documented and told secretly, and a great risk to all the people involved. They are stories that West Papuans want to tell. There is the brutal kidnapping of the daughter of an independence leader by people opposed to her father's politics. The story of a village chief who is fighting to keep his tribe's ancient culture alive. A rebel commander who claims he is now looking for peace and a diplomatic solution to the conflict. And a dancer interrogated for simply holding up a flag, the Morning Star, the independence flag of West Papua. Stories like this are the reason that foreign filmmakers or journalists are rarely allowed into West Papua. This film is one of the first times that West Papuans have had a chance to tell their stories. They want the world to know what is happening to them under Indonesian rule. In the early 1960s, following more than 100 years of Dutch colonialism, plans were underway for West Papuan independence. Instead, Indonesia was ported into power in 1969 in a controversial referendum. Believing they were cheated, many West Papuans have since resisted Indonesian rule.
Papua Merdeka!
Merdeka!
Papua Merdeka!
Merdeka!
Early in 2006, 43 Papuans secretly fled to Australia, claiming they were oppressed and persecuted by the Indonesian authorities. This is the first time that pictures they filmed of their journey are shown. Australian filmmaker Jono van Hest was so moved by the plight of these West Papuans, who are now exiled in Australia, that he decided to help tell their stories. He and a close friend smuggled 6 video cameras into West Papua. They secretly distributed the cameras and trained local people to use them.
Okay, me record it.
The red yes. Recording?
Yes.
That means everything's it's going okay. On tape now. Now it's recording.
Yes.
Based on this exclusive footage, secretly filmed by West Papuans and smuggled back to Australia, these are the stories of West Papua. Jayapura is the largest city in West Papua. Lawyer and political independence leader Edison Waromi lives here with his family.
Kami mohon bahwa rakyat Papua sebenarnya dia sekarang dalam keadaan yang ancaman kepunahan dan sementara terancam. Kelihatan dia bisa makan, minum, sekolah, bekerja, tapi sebenarnya jiwanya sekarang sementara dalam tekanan yang sangat menyakitkan, tekanan yang membuat dia sekarang banyak tidak berdaya.
Like many West Papuans, he wants to feel free in his country. Edison Waromi has dedicated his life to fight for independence. Yana is his 19-year-old daughter.
Bapak sudah pergi selama 12 tahun. Jadi tinggal dengan mama saja. Bapak kembali.
As a university student, Edison Waromi was jailed for raising the West Papuan independence flag, the Morning Star, Since then, he has been jailed 3 more times for similar acts of treason.
Kembali, terus, ya, Bapak masih punya prinsip yang sama, ingin tetap berjuang terus.
Edison Worm is now president of the West Papua National Authority, a political independence group and part of an alliance of West Papuan resistance groups. Because of his fight for West Papuan freedom, Edison claims he is constantly threatened by the Indonesian authorities. But in a case that has never been investigated, it is his daughter who is targeted because of his beliefs in a free West Papua. In a well-planned operation, Yane was drugged and kidnapped on her way home from university. Her 10 kidnappers, who included Indonesians and Papuans, then tortured her. They told her that they wanted to silence her father to stop his struggle for independence. 3 days after her kidnapping, Yani manages to relive the events for her extended family.
Suntik, nenek. Suntik. Dong bilang saya akan mati. Pukul saya, nenek. Dipukul saya. Ditendang saya. Dibilang, dia tidak akan perkosa saya, tapi dibunuh saya mati. Tanya saya ke bapak, terus saya bilang saya tidak tahu. Dan tinggal tanya, terus suntik saya potap.
Ada telepon yang masuk ke dia punya HP, tapi ada balasan dari suara laki-laki yang katakan apa kok?
Mama, kenapa begitu pukul terus?
Di mana mereka siksa dia, jadi situ kami mulai dengar bahwa dia mulai menangis. Aduh, sakit mama, tolong, jangan suntik.
After a night of torture, Yane woke up alone, still locked in the same room. She escaped by climbing out a window. Yane believes that visions of her father helped guide her to safety.
Sadar itu, bapak panggil saya. Yane, bangun. Saya bangun. Saya ikut jendela kecil. Saya jalan ikut jendela itu.
2 weeks later, Yana is still deeply traumatized. Her father is determined to continue his struggle.
The motive of a kidnapper is a politician, not criminal. I don't afraid about accident like this. But this case make I must movement and very strong for independence.
Yane has gone into hiding and has not seen her family in months. She is still in danger, but continues to support her father's political vision.
Di niat ini paling besar untuk Papua ini, jadi ku yang jadi jalan satu-satunya untuk bisa lumpuhkan kupu bapak dengan sekaligus orang yang mau berjuang untuk Papua merdeka ini tahu dengan jalan satu-satunya. Maksudnya dengan Yandung lakukan sama saya.
In the heart of West Papua's Central Highlands, remote villages nestle in amongst the endless jungles and imposing valleys. Anarotali is the administrative central of this area. This is the traditional home to the Mae people, one of West Papua's many indigenous tribes. For many years, this part of West Papua was closed to visitors. Matias Bunai is the chief of a nearby village. From a safe house in Anarotali, he explains that his tribe is under immense pressure. When the military arrived in the 1960s, local villagers were told to fly the Indonesian flag. If they refused, they were accused of being separatist and were often targeted by the military. In Matias's village of Pugodide, houses were burned and sacred traditional objects destroyed. In the past, these people were forced to flee their village, and some died as a consequence. They are afraid that it is only a matter of time before their culture also becomes extinct. Today, Matthias Bunai has gathered his local clans for a pig killing. For many of the indigenous tribes, pigs are treasured and even considered sacred, killed and eaten only on special occasions. But these cultural practices are considered primitive superstitions by most Muslim Indonesians. According to Matthias, Indonesia has no regard for their beliefs. Matthias's ancestors passed the ancient wisdom and cultural law, the Totomana, down through the generations. This ancient law bestows them with custodianship of the land and teaches messages of respect and peace. For this village, celebrating their culture is the ongoing struggle against Indonesian occupation. Matthias wants his people to have the right to determine their own future.
Join me again after the break here on Witness. Welcome back to Witness. I'm Rida Fakhri.
Pride of Warriors brings a unique insight into the struggle of the people of West Papua for self-determination. It's a film made by West Papuans themselves on video cameras smuggled in and out of a country otherwise out of bounds to foreign media.
This secretly filmed story of the West Papuan struggle reaches high into the mountains, where commanders of the Free Papua Movement call for their troops to assemble. Freedom fighters from all over the district, including women and children, are answering the call in the proud display of their colors. This is the first time footage of Thaddeus Yogi's troops is seen outside of Indonesia. These large gatherings are risky and only happen once or twice a year. Thaddeus is the commander of this rebel base, the 5th regional headquarter of the West Papua National Liberation Army, the TPN. Indonesia labeled this group as a terrorist organization.
Merdeka!
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 For 30 years, Thaddeus Yogi has led these men and women in a guerrilla resistance against the Indonesian military.
Sedang tertindas, kita juga bisa bebas dari negara pinggitan dalam waktu dekat ini.
But becoming too old for life as a guerrilla fighter, Thaddeus Yogi is now ready to abandon armed conflict. He knows that his people are no match against the Indonesian military.
Karena selama sepanjang perjuangan peperangan itu kami hanya memakai senjata tradisional, yaitu panah busur, tombak, pisau parang kampak. Jadi itu tidak seimbang dengan senjata modern dari ABRI dan KARI.
Sensing the futility of trying to defeat the Indonesian military, Thaddeus Yogi is now using his authority as commander over this rebel group to stop guerrilla attacks against Indonesians. Thaddeus says his biggest hope is for the international community to intervene. For that to happen, he believes that West Papuan resistance must revert to a non-violent struggle.
Maka itu sekarang kami tujuannya ciptakan zona damai itu supaya ya, dunia luar harus turun tangan supaya membebaskan bangsa Papua, supaya bangsa Papua bisa merdeka sejajar dengan dunia-dunia luar yang telah merdeka.
The Morning Star was going to be the national flag when West Papua was promised independence back in 1961. But once Indonesia took control of West Papua, the Morning Star became illegal. Since then, the Morning Star has become the symbol of the struggle for a free West Papua. Many West Papuans have been killed or imprisoned for raising the Morning Star.
Bendera kebangsaan Bintang Kejora telah siap untuk dinaikkan.
Defiantly, Tadeusi's people raised the Morning Star flag in clear view of Indonesian forces based on the other side of the valley. In doing so, they risk reprisal, but luckily this time there are none. For West Papuans, the presence of rebel groups such as this one, flying the Morning Star in the jungles all over West Papua, continues to keep hopes of gaining independence alive. In Jayapura, a conference is underway. The conference is the major cultural event of the year and attracts a crowd of performers and supporters from all over West Papua. Sampari Dance Group was especially invited to perform for the delegates. Noak Baronsano is the choreographer.
Saya sudah tahu bahwa nanti kalau saya buat tarian kisah kambiak berdarah, jelasnya nanti saya dikejar oleh aparat. Itu sudah di atas kertas dan saya siap orang penanggung jawab. Saya siap penanggung jawab.
The Biak Island Massacre occurred in 1998 when the local community raised the Morning Star flag and called for independence. According to local accounts, the Indonesian forces were ruthless in their response, killing dozens of protesters, men, women and children. Levina Bisai is the lead dancer performing for Sampari.
Nanti begitu sampai di Jayapura sana juga, itu belum kakak dia belum kasih tahu kalau nanti ini kita mau pentas dengan baju bintang kejuaraan, itu kakak dia tidak kasih tahu. Tapi dari sini, mama dong sudah kasih tahu, dong sudah tanya sama orang penari, kamu sudah siap untuk apa jual nyawa atau bilang tuh sudah siap di sini. Kalaupun ke sana untuk mati, tuh sudah siap tuh untuk ke sana. Anak kecil nih dia menangis toh, dia menangis baru dia tanya dia pu bapak, dia tanya dia punya mama nih, dia tanya dia pu mama sama, dia tanya dia mama, dia bilang dia pu bapak ada di mana, terus dia punya mama nih tipu dia tuh bilang dia pu bapak tuh ada pergi. Terus tinggal sampai dia anak nih sudah besar toh. Dia terlalu lihat-lihat di bapak lagi. Dia tanya lagi tuh, mama bapak di mana? Terus di bapak, dia pun mama bilang, kok bapak ada di gunung, ada di apa, di laut, ada di pantai tuh. Dia bilang begitu terus apa? Dia punya anak ditanya lagi. Dia bilang kenapa sampai bapak bisa begitu? Terus dia pun mama jawab tuh, dia mama bilang, kok bapak tuh sudah mati. Langsung dia pun mama kasih tahu, dia bilang, kok bapak tuh sudah mati. Kenapa sampai bapak bisa mati? Terus dia, ibu nih bilang, kok bapak mati tuh karena ini, karena bendera ini. Itu juga macam masih rasa ragu tuh untuk pegang bendera, tapi begitu pegang langsung saya menangis tuh, macam rasa terharu sekali dengan itu. Dan saya bilang bendera tuh macam dia punya satu karisma gitu.
The dance made headline news in the Indonesia-wide media, labeling it is further evidence of West Papuan separatism. 3 weeks later, Noak, Levina, and 11 other dancers were summoned for interrogation by the undercover police.
Ketika kami tampil dengan riksa risa, saya diteror, dianggap bahwa saya mengacau negara Republik Indonesia.
Waktu itu tuh pas mau dipanggil untuk diperiksa tuh saya tahu saja nanti kita ditangkap tuh, ditangkap terus nanti dibunuh.
One of the intelligence officers had filmed her performance and showing her the video on his laptop, pressed Levina to reveal why she had raised the flag.
Masuk lagi tuh yang dia bilang, Levina, ini tuh kita hanya mau bantu kau saja. Daripada kau dibunuh, kasihan ya. Kau cuma mau bantu saja. Kau kasih tahu sudah jujur. Kalau kau tidak jujur juga tidak apa-apa. Kau mau kah dikejar-kejar? Saya diam saja. Saya bilang, hanya senyum-senyum saja. Tidak jawab dia punya itu. Saya diam-diam saja.
There was Papuans performing this flag raising are the 43 refugees who fled to Australia in 2006. They also feared persecution by the Indonesian authorities. Many were actively involved in the West Papuan independence struggle and claimed they were targeted for simple acts like raising the Morning Star flag. While these 43 West Papuans were granted protection in Australia, back in West Papua, many others claim they continue to live in fear. Across West Papua, stories like this are happening every day, but most of them are never heard. All the Papuans that appeared in this film know that they may be targeted for speaking out. However, they want their stories to be told.
That's it for this edition. Thank you for watching, and I hope you'll join me next time here on Witness.